Penguin Random House Canada presents Playing the Long Game, a memoir by Christine Sinclair with Stephen Brunt. Read for you by Rachel Cairns. This book is dedicated to my inspiration, my mother, Sandra Sinclair, the strongest person I have ever known and the reason I am where I am today. You won't get a chance to hear this, but I hope to continue to make you proud. I love you and will miss you forever. Talking about myself has never been something I've liked to do. For anyone who has followed my career, that won't come as a surprise. But I've lived the life of a female athlete. I've helped blaze some trails. I've gone from playing in front of maybe 100 soccer fans to having an audience of millions. You've watched me drop to my knees in defeat and run around the pitch with my arms spread from the sheer thrill of the game. And if there ever was a right time, an opening to push for change, an opportunity to eradicate the fake distinction between women's and men's sports, the time is now. So I'm talking about my career, about what's at stake, hoping that a whole new world will open for the young female athletes coming up, hoping for a different world for my nieces, in sports or out. 1. We're changing the color of the medal. Looking back, I think we were perfectly built for a pandemic Olympics. The thing that has always separated the Canadian women's national soccer team from other teams is how close we are, how connected we are, how much we enjoy each other's company. Athletes like to talk about how they have a great team culture. Ours is unique in my experience, and not just the most recent version. It's a culture that was built over the years. During the pandemic, when we were locked in our hotels or the Olympic Village and couldn't even grab a coffee together at Starbucks, we could still rely on each other. We thrived on that. When the COVID-19 lockdowns hit in March 2020, we were playing in the Tournoi de France. Things were going well. We lost to France, beat Holland, tied Brazil, and it felt like we were on track to have a good Olympics in Tokyo that summer. But the world changed over the course of those few days. The tournament went from completely normal, with fans in the stands, to no fans and no handshakes by the end. I remember our team doctor saying that he didn't think COVID was going to be that big of a deal and that everyone was making more of it than they should. The next thing you know, we were being told to get out of Paris as fast as we could before we were trapped there. The day after we flew home, the NBA shut down, and you know the rest. I spent the first month of the pandemic in Florida. I had planned to go there on the way back from France to visit some friends before the start of the National Women's Soccer League, or NWSL, preseason. It was maybe not the safest place to be, given the lack of restrictions. Gyms closed for 2 weeks, and then they reopened, and everyone acted like COVID was over. I was hearing stories of teammates back in Canada who couldn't leave their houses and thinking that I had it pretty good there in the sun. But then I went home to Portland, Oregon, and things got real. As an athlete, you are on a set schedule. You know exactly what you're doing tomorrow and the next day. Everything is planned out for you. But in the middle of the pandemic, we had to give up on that. Everything was changing so quickly. We had to let go of expectations and learn to accept that, for the time being, there were far more important things on this planet than kicking a ball around. All our players were isolated, and all the clubs were shut down, but we chose to make the most of it. As a team, we were going to use every day in the hopes that there would still be an Olympics. Our goal was to train more efficiently and effectively than our opponents, despite the obstacles. We weren't going to let a lack of games and a lack of normal preparation become an excuse. Our strength and conditioning coach had us doing workouts together on Zoom. Desiree Scott ran a virtual Zumba class. All of us had our own homemade gyms where we could work out as best we could with whatever equipment was available. Mine was in my garage. And then Canada pulled out of the Olympics. I had the same reaction I'm sure a lot of athletes had. What? Really? There is going to be an Olympics and Canada is not going? I've trained my whole life for this. If there's going to be an Olympics, they're going to do it safely. Shouldn't we be part of it? But within a day or two, it became clear that the 2020 Games were going to be postponed for everyone. That was at the end of March. In June, our coach Kenneth Heiner Muller stepped down to take a job in Denmark, his home country. We understood. It was the right move for him and his family. His contract with the Canadian Soccer Association, or CSA, ran through the Olympics. And now there weren't going to be any Olympics, at least not in 2020. He had been offered his dream job. It all made sense. But it meant that we no longer had a coach. As it turned out, we wouldn't have one for a long time. My club team, the Portland Thorns of the National Women's Soccer League, returned to training around that time to prepare for the Challenge Cup, the first bubble event in professional sports. It was distanced training. Everyone got their own little square on the field, trying to prepare to play as a team at a time when we couldn't go near other people. Still, we were proud that the NWSL was the first professional sports league to come back and play. We were the guinea pigs, and the league made it work. We showed it could be done, and safely. The tournament was held in July in Salt Lake City, Utah. It was one of those situations where you had to go in with an open mind and roll with it, and stay grateful just to have the opportunity to play and compete when everything else was still shut down. Our team lived in a hotel in Salt Lake City for 3.5 weeks. We couldn't leave the building except to go to practice or games. And though the food wasn't the greatest, the organizers did their best to make us comfortable. We had a massive games room with foosball and ping pong and a basketball hoop. But being isolated was still hard for players who hadn't experienced anything like it before. I've been traveling with the national team since I was 16 and have been away from home for months at a time, so I adapted more easily than some of my teammates. We played well, but lost in the semifinals. After the tournament, I went home to Portland, and things went quiet for quite a while. That fall, there was a moment where we wondered whether we were ever going to get a head coach. There's only so much a team can do when its players aren't together. But if we had a coach, we could at least start. Diana Matheson had been playing with the national team almost as long as I had. Together, we called the Canadian Soccer Association and told them that the team was starting to stress. They asked for our opinions on what we wanted in a head coach, not for recommendations of individual people, but more generally. We said that we couldn't have a coach that had to start from scratch. There just wasn't enough time to hire someone who didn't know anybody and didn't know the program. A week later, they named Bev Priestman as the new head coach. I don't think many people were surprised. Bev had been involved with our program as an assistant under John Herdman, who coached us from 2011 to 2018. She had also been the head coach of the youth national team, so she knew the athletes, knew how we had been playing, knew the language we used on the field. The first word that pops to my mind when I think of Bev is energy. She is a ball of energy. But we could also tell that she had changed during her time working with the English women's national team. She'd accepted that job after John moved on to coach Canada's men and Kenneth took over our team. She was a more commanding coach than she had been. You could tell from the way she went about the work that John had had an impact on her. John generally does have a big impact on people. Compared to Bev, John is a little more black and white with tactics. With him, you play 3 different formations and know exactly what to do and where to go. Bev likes our game to be a bit more free-flowing, and she puts more emphasis on the players figuring it out for ourselves. John really focused on individual players at a deep level, connecting with each of us and getting the most out of us. With only 7 or 8 months before the rescheduled Olympics, Bev approached us as more of a collective, sparking a team conversation. With time so short, she had to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.